Good evening, folks, and welcome back to Saturday Night Spotlight. And this evening, of course, everyone knows who's a guest, and people have been eagerly awaiting for this moment. I've been getting calls and messages for the last several days now since we announced that finally Mr. Soparrkar is going to be joining us, because we announced this once late last month as well. And somehow my schedules didn't meet up, and I couldn't have Mr. Soparrkar join us. Folks, this is going to be a wonderful evening with him. I would not want to take too much of your time by speaking and making introductory remarks. But I'd like to take a few moments, because if I were to introduce Sandip Soparrkar completely, I am sure those of you who have seen up his work, or who might have searched him up or looked him up on Google, you might have taken almost a couple of hours to just read what's been there. So allow me to put forward a few facts, and then we take off our journey with him. So I guess this evening, he has got 4 national award honors with him. He's the chairperson, current chairperson of India Finance Council, IFAC, as it is known. Mr. Soparrkar also holds a postgraduate degree in business management. And, this is an interesting bit. He has a doctorate in world mythology folklore from the US. This is one of the very rare combinations I've seen who's got a doctorate in world mythology folklore. Sandip is also the first Indian to be certified by the Ballroom Dance Training School from Germany. That is in Bonn, Germany. And in the history of any Bollywood film magazine, Mr. Soparrkar has been the first dancer or the choreographer to grace the cover of a Bollywood magazine. That is some achievement when we have so many of them, and then he happens to be the first one. America's very popular, renowned film dance magazine called Dance Today rates Mr. Soparrkar as one of the 100 most influential dancers in the world. He's been bestowed with the title of the World Peace Ambassador by the World Peacekeepers Movement. The government of US, along with the Lions Club International, honored him with the Visionary Award for developing a ballroom dance program for the blind. Man, this guy doesn't stop anything. Wow. He's also the first Indian dance choreographer who was invited to the UN headquarters to conduct a dance session for the UN staff. And this is stunning. Rolex appointed him as their Indian youth icon. You know, when he got this, I saw that news on Facebook and several other, publications. And I had goosebumps, having somebody who I have known being appointed as an Indian youth icon by Rolex. He was also the first Indian to be invited to judge the Asian Latin and Ballroom Dance Championship held at Colombo, where 32 countries participated with 78 competitive dancers. He's also the first Indian, many firsts to his name, folks. He's also the first Indian invited to be on the jury of Sharm El Sheikh International Theatre Festival, that I guess concluded not too much in the distance in Egypt, along with other top theatre personalities from across the world. He has his own radio show, which was known as Radio Nasha on Radio One, and Fever FM title Out Twist Kare with RJ Sandip Soparrkar. And this received the World Book of Records recognition from London. And this was the world's first radio dance show. Sandip is also one of the board of directors of the prestigious International Business School Washington, IBSW. And our neighbors, the Bhutanese government, honored him by releasing a postage stamp in his honor. Mr. Soparrkar has also been featured on the cover of Robert Cherry's bestseller, the book called Second Tango. And he's been a judge in many, many of these reality dance competitions. We've seen him over the years on DID, DID Doubles, Dance Mukabla US and Canada, Jhalak Dikhlaja UAE, and that was with the mother of Indian, the master, Saroj Khanji. And apart from this, making our Bollywood stars dance to his tunes, he's also choreographed songs for many of these Hollywood stars in some of those movies, and superstars like Jackie Chan, Britney Spears. Folks, I guess I need to stop, because I might go breathless, pushing things your way. He is one of the most phenomenal human beings around. Trust me, if you follow him on Instagram, or if you have been following his work on Facebook, you would find Mr. Soparrkar to be the most humble man around, the most charming person to interact with. And if you were to look into his YouTube videos, his interactions, his talk shows, you will be floored by the kind of person that he is. I'll want to put my first question right up to you, Mr. Soparrkar. Now, I know you share a very, very rich lineage of people in the services. Your father, your grandfather have been in the army. And I guess people from both sides of your family have been in the services. I remember reading somewhere that your great-grandfather from the metal side, he was a forest officer. Because my father was a forest officer. He was from the, so the first batch of IFS. So I somehow couldn't make that connection because, of course, there is a connection. People from services on both sides of your family. And here we have somebody who's picked up performing arts as his career. And friends, you know, performing arts for him, dancing. How long has he been dancing for? It's been half a century. He doesn't look a year older than 25 or 27. But I know Sandip has been dancing from the time he was just a five-year-old child. That's when I believe the armed forces, the army dinners, the ball, dinner balls, they start allowing kids to enter. And that's where children as young as five can walk in. I guess the first dance you had was with your grandmother.
And, yes, absolutely right.
Yeah. So foxtrotting from the age of five to now 50 plus, and you've really blown everyone away with the kind of achievements. Can you just take us through that 50-year journey of yours? A bit more about Sandip Soparrkar, the man, not just the the king of Latin and ballroom dancing.
You know, first about your journey. I want to thank you and I want to thank you, Talks, for getting me here to talk a little bit about myself. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I'm really, really humbled. I would, want to say that this journey of so many years has actually gone off quite fast. From the first step with my grandmother till my college days, I was just dancing as a young boy who was, didn't have any focus in terms of dance. It was all about just enjoying the moment with people, which is very, very beautiful as well. But after I crossed my teenagers, that age, I realized that dance was not about having a partner in your arms. Dance was not about having a beautiful girl swaying to your tunes. Dance was about understanding the importance of being with somebody.
Absolutely.
And that is when I realized how beautiful my dance form was, how fantastic ballroom dancing was. And I think that is when I fell more in love with my dance form and I realized I must do more in my art because it's a gift which has been given to me by God and I must not take it just as the way it's coming. But I must evolve myself and develop myself a lot more so that I can cherish this gift and I can give it away to other people as well.
Sure.
And from my 20s is when I started paying more attention to my dancing. I started paying more attention to what's gone more into my art form. And I realized that ballroom dancing, especially Latin American ballroom dancing, it goes back almost 4,350 years. When the concept of marriage started, that is when the ballroom dancing concept had begun. Because it spoke about like we say in our Hinduism, we talk about the Saptapadi, or we say the Sat Fere, the seven vows that we take with our partners.
Absolutely.
So be it Christianity, be it Buddhism, be it Sikhism, we always have something called, when we bond together with a partner, be it your husband or with your wife, you take these promises that you make to your partner. And to each of these promises is a posture attached in ballroom dancing. That is why, they tell people who are having trouble in their relationship, go and dance together. Because dance will help you to relive those vows each time you're on the dance floor. And that's what excited me towards my dance. And I realized there's so much more. What are these seven vows? What are these cultural differences and changes that are there from Christianity to Hinduism and so much more? And why? What's the common link? And I realized ballroom dancing was the common link. Because even Radha Krishna did the Ras, which was a couple dancing.
Sure.
and ballroom dancing is also couple dancing. So there is somewhere a common thread which connects people and the gods and goddesses, and that is how my journey of learning mythology, learning my own dance began, and slowly it just started going until today I'm learning. So I think I would say these years have gone by really fast. Baal bhi safed ho gaye. Abhi palas bhi khule nahi hai. Abhi can't even go and get it colored. It's actually things which I learned from my people, things which I learned from the people I've been meeting when I travel so much, whether it be my teachers, my parents, my grandparents, or even normally people I meet. I think there's so much to learn from them. That's the where I think my actual education has been. My father was in the army, my grandfather was in the army, and because of which we traveled so much, be it in India or outside India. And it just made me realize that the best way to know about any culture or about any people, any kind of race or any place is when you just know about the dance form. So that is how I would say it all started. And I'm so glad that it happened to me. This travel happened to me because it taught me so much in life.
So, when you started your dancing, at what stage did you really get into the, getting qualified? And when did you really think that you need to move out of India? You went to Germany for your, postgrad, for getting qualified as a dancer. So when did that actually happen? And how did that come around?
It happened immediately after my teenage, and when I said that I want to dance. And I remember telling my father, I said, mujhe dance karna hai. And he said, haan, dance bhi kar lena. I said, dance bhi nahi, dance hi karna hai. And he was like, okay. And it was a big shock for them because we come from a doctor wali family, an army wali family, and suddenly somebody says, humme nachna gana hai. Which becomes a shock for a lot of people, and it was for my parents as well. But I would thank my mother because she, being a Bharatanatyam dancer, she understood, I think, the importance of what dance holds for a person and their heart. And she encouraged me and she said, okay, you are at an age when probably you can try, and why don't you just go and do what you want to do? And give yourself a couple of years. If you think you can achieve what you want to achieve, great. But if you feel you can't achieve things, we are always there for you. Come back. You have education.
Okay.
You can fall back on your education.
I'm sorry. There was audio lag. So, if you were to take us back to your journey when the dance happened, you went on to go on. Now, you mentioned something in the first instance. You said that if God wanted this to be done, if this had to be taken up, in India, we've got the Adi Yogi, Lord Shiva, as the first dancer, the first person who came up with his dancing. We have got Krishna's dances being celebrated across many of our traditional dance formats. In India, we've got some of the best-known dance maestros like Guru Kelucharan Mahapatra, Birju Maharaj, or maybe even for the Western dancers, Shyamak Dawar. They've all come around. These are all males who have come in and dominated, and they've taken the message to people. But why is it? Now, this is a question that plagues a lot of these boys and males, young males, that why is it that males still find it tough to ease into dancing as compared to women and girls? Why is it that there is sometimes a stigma?
This one question I still ask myself, that what is it that men, gender, not just Indian men, okay, men all over the world, why are we so scared to dance? I think I would say, I would blame it mostly onto the parents. Because from a very young age, you are told as a boy, go and play football, go and do this sport, that sport, and so on and so forth. And girls are made to dance. And when a boy said, I want to dance, you are made to do a girly thing. So when a girly thing kind of picture comes in, it suddenly has a little effect on your ego. And you're like, oh my God, am I doing a girly thing? So, though I think today this girly thing and a boy thing has kind of become much lesser, but dance still has a stigma to it. Dance still has a stigma attached to it, and people do feel scared and nervous to come onto the dance floor. But fortunately, somewhere I would say for ballroom dancing, the dance form that I'm into, it's a little better because we have equal partnership. And whatever the man does, the woman does at equally, in fact, sometimes even more. So, yes, but amount of men coming on the dance floor are much less. The confidence that we have as men in ourselves that we can do it is also less. Because when they come in, they are always scared. Can I do it? Kya main kar sakta hu? Kya mujhse ho payega? Main yahan pe aaya hu isliye because mere parents ne mujhe bheja hai ya meri girlfriend mujhe lekar ke aa rahi hai. My wife is bringing me here, so I'm coming. So we are always underconfident to perform on stage. I guess we always sometimes have performance anxiety. So probably this is one of them as well. So I think it just it comes in from there. But one thing I've observed also, once a man starts dancing, his level of commitment is a lot more compared to a woman. Because even in a class of mine, when I'm having any initial part of the class, when there are about, say, 40 girls, and there'll be about 3 or 4 men. But after 5 years, those 3-4 men are still there, but those 40 women have slowly trickled down to just a few of them. It's because I think they can really pick up fast. The girls can really do much better in terms of dancing. So they kind of want to move from one to the other. And they have kind of gone from one place to the other place. But the men stay put there because they start to love what they're doing. Because it's a dance, especially ballroom dancing, that's a man's dance. And it whatever we do on the dance floor, whatever she does on the dance floor is all because we guide them to do it. So somewhere you start feeling confident about yourself that yes, you can lead the lady not only in your house as a leader, but also on the dance floor.
Okay, so there is
I'm losing your voice. I can't hear you.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, now I'm okay.
All right, cool. So, of course, many a times, I go back to your statement earlier on, your earlier interactions. You mentioned that dance also needs to be looked at by parents as a means of, or maybe as a career too. Now, how would that actually, take shape? Because in our country, dance at times, the kind of dance, Western dances, they have taken up many a times to win a few applause or maybe get into the good books of people. But is it also something that can provide for a family? You, for one, have been providing for many families.
You know, sir, I think the biggest problem is in the way we look at art form, not just dance. Huh? I'm talking about music. I'm talking about singing, painting, playing any art, in any kind of instrument as well. Everywhere, there is it's a hobby. School ke baad mein bachcha kya karega? Okay, let's send them to dance class and that also, or a music class just close to our house, so that the child doesn't have to travel too much. But for your education, you will make the child travel for an hour or 45 minutes by bus or whatever. And that's because we feel education is very important, but we don't understand or we don't realize that art can teach you a lot more than what studies can teach you. Because art is one thing which really makes you understand the roots of the culture, of the country, of the people. Because that's from where we all come. That's what we are made of. Today is the science, physics, mathematics, biology that we are talking about. Yes, it's there. Of course, it's important. It's important to study that. But when you have the education of your culture, when you have education of any culture, it will make you much stronger as an individual. It will make you much stronger as a person and therefore grow much better and understand different things of life. But we are always looking at dance or art as a form of hobby. If they understand that it's not that way, people can make money out of it. If you're looking at a profession, then yes, you can make it a profession. I have made it a profession. There are so many more who have made it a profession. It can, but yes, you have to understand one thing most important is that you have to always learn all your life. You cannot say that I have achieved and I have reached and now there is no more. Because that's not what it is going to be. Art is one field. It's like the sea. Samundar hai itna bada ki aapko zindagi bhar usme agar aap gote khaoge to bhi aap bahar nahi nikal paoge. It is that kind of a beautiful feeling. And sometimes our children don't have that patience, because it requires that patience. It requires, even if you are 70, 80 years old, you are still learning. Sure. And do you want your child to go through that? If your child is determined and if your child has ability, then you must make them dance or make them learn any art form, because it will enrich them so much more, and therefore bring happiness not only into that person's life, but in the life of so many other people.
Sure. You know, as a parent, or as parents normally do, they would watch somebody like Shyam Agarwal, or they would watch you in performance. And seeing you, or looking at the way that life has shaped itself around you, or you have worked hard into getting it as a career, so they get inspired. You are a role model. They take their kids to a dance class in the neighborhood, and they would say ki mere bachche ko bhi western dance sikha do, wo saab ko dekha tha screen pe, unke jaisa dance karna sikha dijiye. Yeah. Ab ye jo class wale hote the, with all due respect to all the masters and teachers, a lot of these people, they do not get into anything called basics, but they would want a few sequences to be taught. They would want that child comes in, day one, he knows nothing, he has got two left feet, like I've always had. And day seven, before and after, dekho aapka bachcha dance karne lag gaya. There is no history. There is no Natya Shastra, as Natya Shastra is being taught. Yeah. I guess the Western dance has its own studied version, orchestrology. I don't know if that's the right phrase, yeah, but the right term. What do we do with these kind of people? Because people want quick fixes. How does this take hold? How do we tell the parents that it's not a quick fix? It's not a overnight kind of a, you pop a pill and things will happen. What would you suggest to these people, these kind of parents who really want the kids to dance, but they just want, Soparrkar saab ko dekha hai, unke 3-4 sequences hamare bachche ko sikha dijiye.
First of all, I think the parents must understand that this is not their choice, but it should be the choice of the child. So, apni khud ki mahatvakankshaye hame apne bacche pe nahi dalni chahiye. So, we must understand that the child wants to learn a dance form or not. First, that's what's most important. Not because I want my child to dance, it should be my child wants to dance. That is one thing. Second, I would also say is that it's important that we must not get influenced by Bollywood. There is so much of influence of Bollywood in our life today. So much. Right from TV to cinema to everywhere, we are seeing Bollywood. And we feel that is what is dance. We feel that is what is the ultimate thing in life. There are people, or even television, there are people coming to me saying that I want my child to be in a dance reality show. Now, that can't be your goal in life. When you tell I want my child to be a doctor, I want my child to be an engineer, you are having an aim to reach a certain point. A reality show can't be an aim. A reality show can be a way up there. It can be one of the paths to reach up. So, your aim needs to be right. Your vision has to be right. And then you must choose a right institute, a right school that's going to impart that knowledge to your child. Like we choose our schools for our children. We are sending our kids to IB schools, to different types of international schools, because we choose that particular school, hoping that that's what they're going to do in their future. Same thing you have to do for a dance class or any art class as well. Just because somebody is in my neighborhood does not make that person eligible to be teaching the right thing. Maybe they are. I'm not saying a no for it. But do your homework. Check what they are teaching them. What is there in the school of dance? What is the syllabus like? What is the attire like? There are people coming into a dance class, a ballroom dance class of mine, which requires you to wear heels, requires you to wear a certain type of shoes, wearing sports shoes and coming. When I go for my aerobic class, I will wear sports shoes and track pants. But when I go to a dance class, I can't wear sports shoes and a track pant, because that dance should demand it. Like you go for a classical dance, you will wear no shoes. You will carry your ghungurus with you. You will wear a pajama kurta. You will wear a sari or whatever, But when it comes to a Western dance, you look at it so casually. I think that's what the attitude towards it is needs to be changed. Maybe it's very new culture into our country. It's just a couple of years old. It wasn't so popular before. Now it's kind of picking up. So it's still trickling in as to what really the culture of the dance form is supposed to be. Is anybody teaching anything about the dance form really, or is just going to put some Bollywood gana and say, okay, chalo, abhi aap hip hop kar lijiye, abhi aap contemporary kar lijiye, abhi aap salsa kar lijiye. If that's what it's going to be, then I think we need to think twice before we put our child into that particular school. And because right education is very, very important.
Absolutely. You know, your take on education, because I do hear people, you know, coming and commenting about you or thanking you quite often. Guru Purnima ke din pe, I read a lot of remarks about you, and one of them was very beautiful. I was so delighted because somebody said that, thank you, Sandip sir, for introducing me and my husband to the magic in the world of dance. But it was your relentless guidance, and this is what is important, the relentless guidance. How do people find somebody with that kind of passion to give? Because I have known you to be somebody who's always been very humble, you've always been a giver, and you've never turned your back on anyone. So how do people figure out somebody, how to find a coach like you?
You know, one thing I remember when I was wanted to take up dance as a profession, when my passion wanted to take a professional turn and probably earn out of it, my grandparents said a very beautiful thing to me. They said, "Uska dhanda mat banana. You are taking it up as a profession. Profession is different. But don't make it a business.
Sure.
Don't, this passion that you have started off with, don't let that die, because that's what is very, very important. That's what will keep you going. Because once you become money-minded, once you become business-minded towards your passion, it doesn't remain passionate anymore. So you need to make sure that you are keeping that fire alive inside you. And remember one thing. I remember my great-grandfather's words. Oh my God, they still ring in my mind all the time. He was doctor to Mahatma Gandhi. And he said a very beautiful thing. He said, ki, talwar aur top, yudh jeet sakti hai. Lekin kala aur kalam, yudh chhed sakti hai. I can never forget it.
Yeah.
So if I am a kalakar, I have the ability to ignite a war. And if that war can be not just a war can be war within yourself. And that war can then finally get you into this peace mode. And that's what your art can do. And if as a dancer, I don't do that for myself and for my people who are joining me in and joining hands with me, then what's the purpose of my opening a dance school, or what's the purpose of my being a dancer? This gift, like I was saying, has been given to me. I must not be proud of it. I should be able to distribute it to everybody else with as much passion as it has been given to me with.
Sure. In your giving your gifts to people, in your sharing, I guess you further become richer, not in just terms of what people do, the business bit, but as an experience as well. You've often mentioned and often said that dance for you is life completely. For people, it might be a way of expressing themselves or something. It might be something which people like to do as a hobby. But for me, dance is life. It has been said many a times. You would also corroborate the fact that dance for a lot of people has been therapy. Dance has been therapeutic for many people. For these kind of people, who want to look within themselves and figure out how to fight their demons, how should somebody take on to that journey of getting into dancing?
Sir, it's very, very simple. You just have to let yourself go. Just go with the flow of dance. अपने आप को पूरा समर्पण समर्पण करना है, अर्पण करना है डांस को. एंड व्हेन यू डू दैट, यू विल ऑटोमेटिकली बेयर ऑल द फ्रूट्स दैट कम्स अलोंग विद इट. सो इट्स नॉट ओनली अबाउट स्टेइंग फिट एंड लुकिंग ग्रेट, इट्स ऑल्सो द मेंटल एंड द स्पिरिचुअल सैटिस्फैक्शन दैट यू विल गेट. एंड यू विल नॉट इवन रियलाइज इट, यू विल नॉट इवन नो द इफेक्ट्स दैट्स कमिंग टू यू. एंड ऑटोमेटिकली यू विल स्टार्ट फ्लोइंग इन दैट रिवर of dance, which will finally culminate into the sea, the ocean of knowledge. And it will just come to you, but you just have to go there without thinking. Like when Krishna had stolen the clothes of the gopis, they came up surrendering themselves, right? Now that surrendering is what's important. You surrender yourself to the Almighty. You surrender yourself to the art form, because your art form is your Almighty. And if you just go there with, if you go there with a purpose, मुझे ये करना है, मुझे वो करना है, मुझे ऐसा सीखना है, इसलिए मैं सीख रहा हूँ. When you have a purpose attached to it, you will never bear the fruits of it. You just have to just do it without thinking, without, like they say, you should dance as if nobody is watching. Same way, you should just give yourself to the art form as if nobody is there. It's just you and your art form. And you will start just enjoying the, it, like it falls like rain on your head and you'll be like, wow, what happened to me?
This is so beautiful. You just need to immerse yourself into it, surrender yourself, and then let things happen. You do not conform to the traditional image of a Bollywood choreographer.
Now,
you're not a very traditional Bollywood choreographer. Jo aake gaane pe sabko
na. Master ji.
Yes, Master ji aapko nahi ho. You know. Considering some of them, you might still be pretty young into Bollywood at, you know, 20 years. It's just been, I think, the first movie, 2001, Zubeda. Shyam Benegal, you know, ke saath aapne jo first movie shayad apni choreograph ki thi, where I guess Manoj Bajpayee proposes to Karishma in a ballroom. Can you share a bit about that experience? Because it might be very interesting for people to know, how did somebody who is a maestro on the ballroom dancing, he come on to a very structured but unstructured world of Bollywood choreography, because everything happens only based on the whims and fancies of a few people. So how could somebody with your kind of a classical knowledge come in and establish his presence on the world of movies as well?
You know, it just happened. I was at a nightclub dancing and a man just comes over and just hands me a card. Call me. And I was like, okay, what's this? Call you for what? So I said, okay, let me just do it, you know, because the way he came, it looked as if he, there was something in him which was like, there is something I have for you. So I gave a call to him and it's just a call, right? So I said, okay, let me just call him. And he said, it looks you're a ballroom dancer and we have, I would like you to meet somebody. There's a film that we would probably want you to choreograph. And I was like, okay, I'm not a choreographer. I have never done it before in my life. And don't worry, just come and meet and we'll see. And I go to the office without knowing whom I'm meeting. And I meet Shyam Benegal, sir. And he was fantastic. He said, don't worry, I will teach you everything. And today, whatever I know, I would say is all because of him. Because he taught me everything from camera angles to lenses to movements to everything about what's required for film choreography. It was him and Vishal Bharadwaj, sir, who taught me the most. Ketan Mehta taught me a lot. These are some directors that I worked with. And I think it just fell on my lap. And I have always believed that whatever comes to you, you must never say no to it. Because you never know what new doors open for you. And so whatever opportunities has come knocking, it means it's been sent by him. And you must open the door and receive it with open arms. And most important part is do it at the best of your ability.
Sure.
That's what is important. It should not be that you're doing kamchori in it, because then it will never work for you.
Sure.
So whether it was my first song or my last, which I've done till today, I have always given it all that I have, be it my rehearsals, be it my setting up of a song, or even doing my camera division. I still today take my paper and pen and write down my camera division, and my assistants tell me, sir, I will do it for you. So now you also do, I'll also do. Because for me, that's my homework, which still goes on. So we will have 2-3 division of my shots. One, my assistant will carry. One, I will carry for myself. Because I think till today, we all, like I said, we all keep learning all the time. Every song which I have done, be it Saath Khun Maaf, be it Mangal Pandey, be it any of the movies that I have done, Dil To Bachcha Hai Ji, so many of them, with such big stars, every movie has taught me so much in my own profession, because I was never a technician in terms of dancing. And every time I went on set, I did learn a lot of things. Madhur Bhandarkar taught me so much when I was doing Dil To Bachcha Hai Ji. So I think these people who come into your life, they enrich you in so many ways. And I'm glad I've met so many of them all over the world with so many of my shows and events and my films.
Beautiful. How was your experience, creating a sequence and choreographing somebody who is known to be one of the best dancers like Hrithik Roshan, Kites?
Oh my God, I think it's very simple and at the same time extremely difficult. Because when you're setting up something, you have to always think, kya wo karega? Oh my God, wo to kar lega aram se. So let me just make something more difficult. So I have to be continuously on my toes, actually on my toes, so that I can prepare something extraordinary. Because the person is extraordinary and they need to do justice to what you're showing them. At the same time, they have to supersede what they have been doing as well. So it's a lot of responsibility on your shoulders. Be it Kites or be it his HRX launch that we did or his Britannia ad that we did. There's so much more that I had worked with him. It was all, every time I was like, hey Bhagwan, is this good enough? Will he make changes to it? You know, of course I have to get approvals from my director for it. But in a sense, I need to make sure that I am going ahead of the benchmark that they have created for themselves and which I have created for them as well. So it's a lot of responsibility. It's stressful because, you know, you want to not take it easy just because I have Ritik with me. Okay, it's great because wo to achha kar lega, chalo, theek hai. But achha definitely karega. In fact, bahut achha karega. But it's a lot of responsibility on our shoulders to put it forward for them because whatever they do on screen, whatever you see them do on screen is all our imagination. It's all our techniques and we have to be best at it.
You've had your mother who was also a classical dancer and I don't know, but you have been very, very respectful and you've given the Indian classical dancers, the masters of Indian classical dance, all these gurus, you've always been very respectful towards them. Do you get the same back in return? Do people really respect?
It doesn't matter. I think for me, what's important is I respect their education. I respect the place where they are right now in, the struggle that they have gone through. I'm so happy that Sonal Mansingh ji calls me her dancing son. I'm so glad Maharaj ji meets me every time he comes to Mumbai city. I feel so nice when all these legends, be Pratibha Prahlad, so many of them who are close to me and who share various things with me. I think it's because somewhere deep in my heart, you know, I am a dancer and I think we dancers are all the same. There is a very beautiful Kabir ka doha, you know, which says, Jati ne poochho sadhu ki, pooch lijiye gyan. Jati ne poochho sadhu ki, pooch lijiye gyan. Mol karo talwar ka, padi rehne do mian. So, why are we saying that you are a classical dancer, you are a Western dancer, you are a folk dancer? We all are dancers. Cool. And that is what connects us. That's what bonds us. It is you and me and others who say, okay, you are in this bracket and that bracket, that department, this department. Finally, we all are the same. So through my writing, which I do for various newspapers and my columns that I have, I think I always like to speak about all dancers, be it a dancer on high heels, be it a dancer, a belly dancer, be it a classical dancer with gungurus on. It doesn't matter because after all, we all have the same heart, we have the same soul and we are probably going to the same place. Our focus and our goals are the same.
Amazing. This is like I always tell people that if you need to learn humility and if you need to learn some of the basics of how to become successful in life, you need to look into what Mr. Soparrkar has been doing because he's always been so gracious in everything that he has done. And he's been so welcoming. I just wanted to know one thing about you being an influencer. Now, as an influencer, it's not just people within the country that you influence. You've been a global influencer. You've been recognized and honored several times by the government of US, the government of the state of New Jersey. You've received so much of accolades. Queen Elizabeth, I believe Prince Charles, they've also written to you. Being an influencer, the way that you are, do you also believe that you can be the bridge for cultural integration? Maybe Indian dancers can go abroad on your shoulders. Would that also happen sometime? Or is it already happening?
Well, that's what we are doing. It is already happening. We are doing that through India Fine Arts Council. And we are sending dancers, be it classical or folk dancers, or even Western dancers. We're sending them various shows and events all over the world. And I think it's a tough job because there are so many applications that keep coming in. And as a chairperson of the India Fine Art Council, it gets very difficult to choose the right one. I know sometimes how politics also plays a lot of, it's India after all, and it can get quite difficult. But we are already doing it. I think that's what is important. We need to make sure to tell people of the world that India is has got great dancers. Dancing is in our blood. We dance at birth, we dance for death, and everything within and between that, we are dancing. And it does not matter what dance forms we do. We are just great dancers. Like we say, Africans are great dancers. Indians are also great dancers. And it should reach to the world. And whether be it through shows, be it events, be it television shows, I think wherever India can get recognition, I have always recommended India in different ways. But yes, I have been very partial towards my country and my countrymen. I guess that army thing comes into me all the time. But why not? If I have the position to use it, I would definitely use it to promote my people, my country, and what we do.
Okay. You know, it might sound very cliched, but what is your view about, the young kids being put under the grill and coming on with huge bits of expectations on reality shows? You've been a judge quite a few times. You've seen people come perform. What probably people see on screen might not be the struggle that's behind the screen. What are your views on that? You know, pushing your child to get ready for a reality show.
I think it's important to push the child for a. It's okay to push a child for a competition, but pushing the child to attain glamour and to attain stardom, I think that's what is not right. And that's what I see parents do. Popularity milegi, hamari society mein log hamari wahwahi karenge. We'll have big name happening in our city or in our society or locality. That is what the aim is. So I think the stress on the child is a lot more. I have to do justice to what my parents are thinking, what I have to prove to other people. You must take part in a competition to prove it to yourself, not to prove to anybody else. Because when you prove it to yourself and you keep increasing your benchmarks over and over above what you're already doing, you will definitely be the winner. And a reality show is just a part of your growing process of dancing. If you are in a reality show, it will help you, yes, learn so much more, so many different art forms. It will help you understand camera, stage, lighting, costuming, you know, work under stressful situations because you just have a few days to prepare for a new dance form. You learn a lot more than just dance on a reality show. And it's good to learn all that. But also prepare yourself for disappointments that come your way because life will always never be great. It will have its ups and downs. So if you're out and eliminated of a reality show, don't get disheartened and stop dancing. I have seen so many dancers who have stopped dancing because they couldn't reach the top three. And they are fantastic. And when I call them, come and do a show for me, no, sir, I'm not going to do it, I'm getting older. Baal jhad gaye hain and I'm disappointed and I'm sad I could not, you know, come in top six, top three. Now that's the our ambitions need to be more to dance rather than to win something, because dancing is winning. A competition is not winning.
Beautiful. You don't enter a competition just to be among the top three or top six, because that again, you know, labels you as either a winner or a loser. Stay away from that. Any bit of, discrimination that you face internationally, being an Indian, expert in ballroom dancing or Latin dancing, because we see all these, people in Hollywood movies, either Latinos and Antonio Banderas or people like that coming in, and you being from in the Indian subcontinent, any kind of challenges being an Indian into that field globally?
Yes, definitely, because we are brown skin and brown skin is looked at differently to a white skin. So yes, racism, yes, I have faced in a lot of places when I have traveled abroad. But I think what makes me win the situation is the warmth that I carry with me for the people that I'm with, because I genuinely feel there's lots to learn from them and there's lots that probably they are better than me in so many ways. So I have never said that I have achieved it and I'm here because I've achieved it. Because I still feel I haven't achieved and there's lots more for me to learn. And when I'm standing there waiting to take as a student, I think they open up much more easily towards things. And I have been welcomed after that. And once the doors have been opened, I have not had any problems. So yes, initially there were problems. And now also sometimes when I go to a new place, I do, I'm looked at like, okay, what's this guy all about? But I guess when you are just genuinely nice with somebody, they understand that there is no game someone is playing here. One is just here for the love of art form. And we are just here for the same purpose together. So I think that's what is most important. And I don't bother if there's a racism affecting, because I feel if you just give with genuinity to somebody and with an open arms and open heart, you'll always receive love back again.
Awesome. You know, a lot of people at times, they get cold feet when they have to do something and perform in an area where there are going to be people from other cultures also coming in. And I have seen this quite frequently in my coaching journey, cross-culturally. We find people, you know, developing cold feet and they step back. So I guess what you just mentioned, that might be a great bit of motivation for those people who are fence-sitters yet to move in on to the other side. You know, let people take note of the work that you've been doing. Yeah. Great. Can you share a bit about your role as a chairperson of the India Finance Council? Because I do quite, you know, read about your work and a lot of that goes into making this council, and then how would artists who are not only into the performing arts, but other bit also, how do they benefit through the Finance Council?
The India Fine Arts Council is a body which promotes artists, be it musicians, singers, dancers, painters. We want to even include fashion designers into it, actually, but we are still kind of thinking as to what to kind of do for that. A little bit of actors and theater as well. So we send dancers all over the country and outside the country, depending on what festivals are being taken place. There are some which are funded by India Fine Arts Council, and there are some which are not funded but only are supported by India Fine Arts Council. So we people apply to us who are interested, and we have a huge database of artists. And depending on what that other festival is looking for, okay, we then have a selection that happens internally, because we already have the information with us, or we already have their biodata and resumes and what they have performed or what they have done. And accordingly, we choose the right candidates. And we, if in case it requires some more training, they have been given that as well. And then they go ahead and they represent India at various, or their state at different festivals and events.
Okay. So if somebody wants to be a part of the Finance Council, how does somebody do that? Is there a protocol to follow to be a member, or it's selection?
No, there's
only
no membership. It is just, you just apply, just write, send in your email with your biodata and resume, your videos if you have any. It's a little bit nice actually if you send videos. And then we just keep you in our database and we just keep looking for things. And hopefully you will get a call, because as of now we have so many of them. We have, I don't even remember the number of artists that we have on the list, because it's just huge list. But yes, we have tried, especially I have tried, that I would try not to repeat my artists, because I think everybody should get a chance. So because there are so many dancers, so many musicians, and they all are good. So why should I only pick up one every time? So maybe, yes, I have tried my best. I will not say I've always done it, but I've tried my best to give chance to everyone. And okay, this time you go, next time you can go. And like, we just give opportunities to each person, because I think everybody should get a chance to represent the country and showcase a talent more than anything else.
Great. We've got somebody who's you know, a classical dancer. She's also trained her daughters to be a classical dancer. Mrs. Rajeshwari Jain, she hails from Ahmedabad. She has this question that, do you feel every dancer should learn the basics through the classical art form first and then diversify? How important is this besides giving them an edge, because they might have been schooled through the primaries? So your take on this?
Well, okay, learning classical dance form is extremely important. That should be your base. Now, classical does not mean Indian classical. Classical can even mean Western classical. So be it ballet or ballroom, which is a classical form, Western dance form, or be it your Bharatanatyam, Kathak, Kathakali, Kuchipudi, Mohiniyattam, whatever classical dance forms are there. If you learn a classical dance form, your base gets stronger. you understand the dedication, determination required for any dance form, and then you can build on it the way you want to build. Then you can do folk, you can do Bollywood, you can even do other Western dance forms like hip hop and contemporary, so much more. And you can become a versatile dancer if you wish to, or you remain a classical dancer if you want to, because that's what is important. More than that, also, I would say is don't divert yourself too much. Don't deviate in too many things. I have done this also, that also, folk also, this. When you do 10 things, then you become master of none. So you need to start with a basic training of classical. If you feel you are more inclined toward doing something else, go ahead and do it, no problem. But then be in that particular zone. Don't just spread your wings too much, because when you do that, then you will just fall down.
Okay. We've got somebody who's one of India's most celebrated Mehndi artists. Her name is Nimisha. Now, Nimisha, I was for you ki aapne kaha ki business mat banao apne art ko. Lekin aisa kaha gaya ki ghoda ghas se dosti karega to khayega kya? So, how to keep your passion alive and ensure that passion also continues to remunerate you? Because for people like Nimisha, you know, she has been one of the finest trainers of for Mehndi artists. She made a Mehndi Wali, that term, she made that obsolete and created the term Mehndi designer, Mehndi artist. Now, she's a very genuine question. Ki hum to isi se kamate bhi hain. Yehi hamara passion hai. And she's been doing it for us for almost 4 decades. So, to Nimisha, what would be your suggestion?
My suggestion is going to be to her is very simple. Honesty in your profession is important. Because many a times in art, the honesty goes away. So if a student is coming to me who requires a lot more hard work in his art form, I must not say, very good, tum bahut achha kar rahe ho, chalo, chalo, chalo. No, I need to make sure I tell them the truth. Because as a teacher, as a person who's running an institute, it is my responsibility and my duty to tell them exactly what they need to work on. Because I cannot be showing them the wrong mirror. I have to show them the correct mirror. And that is what I'm saying. Don't make it a dhanda. And at the same time, so-and-so is coming. This is a rich man's son. Okay, let me hike the fee for them. Okay, you pay me so much money. That one is coming. Oh, this is poor. Tha, kam kar deta. That is not what's right. So if you want to reduce your fee for a person who can't afford it, great, you should do that. But the one who's probably more privileged, who's coming to you to learn to dance, you can't say, okay, tu mujhe extra paisa de do, because that's not what's right. So you set a mark for yourself. These are my fee structure, which I have, which is fine. And that is what you will work on. You can't go ahead of it. You can come down for sure because of different needs of people. But that's what I mean by don't make it dhanda, which a lot of people do it. If you go to the market, you're bargaining for sabji because it's costing 20 bucks, somebody charging you 30 bucks. And that's what it's called dhanda. Now, you must not make it a dhanda. That's what I meant.
True. Don't keep it, specifically only for that particular purpose. Mr. Pramod Akula, he has a question for you that what is your take on the cultural impact or the benefits of, the field that you're in native cultures or cross-culturally? How do these things get integrated?
I would say the best integration is through music, dancing, food, and through traveling. Because when you actually go and see various cultures, be it our own and compare it to somebody else, like I was talking to you in the beginning about the seven vows and the Saptapadi, we all have the same thing. It's just that we as human beings have divided the place with region. Othum, you are a Britisher and I'm an Indian and you ruled over me, and you are a Latin American person and I'm an Indian, or I'm an Asian and you are a black person. I think that's what is not nice. So if when you travel, you understand the culture, the food, the music, like I said, it just covers the gap, because that's when you realize we all are same people. So when you study about the gods and goddesses, you realize that they all are same. So whether I'm talking about a Cupid and a Psyche, which is from the Greek mythology, or I speak about Kamadev and Rati from Indian mythology, they are same. They all are God of love. So I think somewhere we have divided them. But their fears, their tears, their happiness, everything is just the same. Stories might differ slightly. The Vesh Bhushta might differ slightly, but they are actually just the same. So we need to understand, and that will only happen if you study about other cultures apart from your own culture.
Okay.
So you need to first have your strong base and then branch out to everybody else and understand as to how everything is the same tree.
So your PhD, your research into the world mythology folklore, how much of that helped you evolve as a dancer? Because you're just saying that a bit of a culture here. So how much of your research helped you in the work that you do now?
Oh, it helped me a lot. I think today what I am is only because of my study of international culture. Because I'd reached a position when I realized that, like I said, it was the common thread was my art form. And that is what was joining everything else. So when I'm studying about various mythologies or various gods and goddesses, and I'm comparing it to mine. Because okay. I honestly feel that our Indian mythology is really vast and it has a great history behind it and a lot of tradition behind it, but others are no less. So I compare it and I find common links. And then I try to bring it into my dance form. So there are so many more dance, there are so many acts which I have done in Western dances with international stories or with Indian stories to it. And I think that's what excites me, because I'm bringing the gods alive. And they say, Purva Janam Sukrutam, which means you have done something great in your previous life that has given you this life. So this life, when I can actually enact those stories of gods and goddesses, I have done something great in my previous life. That is why I've been bestowed upon this honor of presenting a life of gods and goddesses to other people.
Cool. This is really interesting for people who are, you know, willing to extend themselves, stretch themselves into learning a little more about what they need to do, maybe their own field. I don't have too much time, and I understand 8 o'clock, you have one more webinar to get into. That's with the Sakshi team, if I'm not wrong.
Yes.
So, yes, I'll just take 2 or 3 minutes of your time. Now, 5 years and your first dance, a foxtrot with grandma. It gave us 50 years of Sandip Soparrkar. What next?
And where there is next? So much more. There is so much more. I'm still, I think I have not achieved anything at all. There's so much more for me to do. I would love to take my dance for a cause all over the world. Right now, we are already in a few countries, but I would like to actually take it all over the world. And I would want my radio show to go into its next season. We are already in our second season, but I would want it to go to my third and fourth season. I think I'm always very, very ambitious to take my things ahead with, of course, sincerity and genuinity. So I think that's what keeps me going. There's a very beautiful poetry of Gopal Das Neeraj-ji, which says, Dukhme nacho, sukhme nacho, jeevan hai tata thayyare. Dukhme nacho, sukhme nacho, jeevan hai tata thayyare. So we don't know when it's going to go away. So keep dancing, keep enjoying what's coming to you, because that's what real life is about. Because this golden breath which has been given to me, I don't know when it will go away. So I must just keep dancing and must just keep exploring a lot more.
Beautiful, you know. But are we going to see a little more of Sandip Soparrkar on screen, or our twist curry, maybe new seasons coming in? are we going to have something which we have not seen happening on the screen as well anytime soon?
Yes, you will, because I just finished shooting for a Bollywood film as a main lead, and the film is called I Am Not a Porn Star, Nazar Sambhal Ke. It's a very controversial.
Oh yes, I read about that.
Yeah, so it was supposed to release in the month of February, but then because of this lockdown little fear, they have pushed it now. So I hope it should be releasing next year. So it's something new which I have done. I had never experienced it before. Always been behind the camera, but now suddenly to be in front of the camera was a complete different ball game altogether. So I think, yes, definitely. And this morning, my radio station spoke to me by saying, we are doing the reruns of my season one, and we're going to halfway through our season two, and it's going to be probably seeing a season three as well. So I think I'm looking forward to new things.
Awesome. I guess, you've already commenced your classes once again with those masks and sanitizers.
Yeah. So
a couple of those videos, and I'm sure people are going to see a lot more of you. That poster of your movie, I guess it had a massive response. I saw that as well. It was so well received. The title is going to get people into the theaters the minute it's put up or maybe on the online platform, wherever it happens. With this, we wish you all the very best for your movie,
Thank you.
Next 50 years of the Sandip Soparrkar brand of excellence. I believe we have so much to learn from you. I believe there's so much of life to be, you know, understood through your moves, through your the way that your feet move. I guess there's so much of, you know, Sandip Soparrkar we need to awaken within us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much for coming on board Youth Talks. My audience has been absolutely delighted. This is one question maybe you can answer if at all, you know, you'd want. Maybe you would have been a chef having done your, you know, hotel management with cuisine or something.
Yes, if I've not been a dancer, I think I would have definitely been in my hotel industry because I was just about talking to one of my friends who was the general manager of a hotel that, you know, I missed the hotel industry. Can I come back, maybe work twice for me in the hotel? Because I think it's, you learn so much when you're with people, interact with people. If I was not a dancer, I would have definitely been a hotelier. And I might just want to go back to it. You never know. So never say never.
All right. So with that, once again, thank you so much.
Thank you.
You know, people love you the way you are. Once, I guess, you put up a small picture of yours with, you know, the salt and pepper and the regular bread.
Nobody wants to see an old man dancing.
The people love you the way you are naturally. And this is what women have to say about you. So I guess, you know, please continue the way you are. Thank you once again, Sandip, for being on Youth Talks. Look forward to maybe a meeting next time and possibly
Thank you. I'm so glad.
It would be a great, great pleasure. Thank you once again.
Lovely talking to you. Thank you.
Enjoy yourselves until next Saturday with a new guest. This is Himadri. Wish you a very happy...
That I'm not giving you.